Is it as hard to believe for you as it is for me that it was just a week ago Purdue played UConn in the national championship game? The Boilermakers, of course, back-to-back regular season champs, got to the Natty for just the second time ever, first time since 1969. They were part of a group of six teams that made the NCAA tournament. Illinois made it all the way to the Elite Eight. Nebraska was in the tournament, and because of that season and 23 wins, Fred Hoiberg was named the Jim Phelan National Coach of the Year. Back inside Big Ten today in our Big Ten Network studios, Rick Pizzo joined by Trent Meacham. Purdue's run certainly wasn't unexpected. It was impressive, as was Zach Edey winning both Big Ten and Naismith Player of the Year 2 years in a row. But the Boilermakers weren't the only team that had a really impressive season. Your alma mater, Illinois, making a run to the Elite Eight.
Yeah, I think overall for the Big Ten, it was a solid year. And what you want is to have the opportunity to compete for championships, and we'll start with those two teams, Purdue and Illinois. Purdue, obviously, after losing to a 16 seed, the run that they went on the entire year, their year of dominance, another Big Ten title, so impressive. Zach Edey's going to retire from his Purdue uniform as a legend in college basketball, one of the best to play in this conference in the history of Big Ten play. And I look at Illinois, and then look, a team that did it very differently. Matt Painter's done it through development for the most part. And yes, Brad Underwood's done that. Coleman Hawkins developed over the course of his career at Illinois, but bringing in a lot of transfers. And Illinois kind of getting back to the top of the Big Ten, won a Big Ten tournament title in Minneapolis, advanced to the Elite Eight, I think was Final Four good, Rick. They ran it up against UConn and wasn't quite that good.
But nobody was.
But those two teams, you know, you did what you wanted to. You have the talent, you have the ability to put yourself in position to get to the Final Four to win a championship.
Meanwhile, there were a couple of teams that were somewhat surprising with their level of success, Northwestern and Nebraska. Boo Booey just continued to impress. Chris Collins did maybe his best coaching job ever, and that was the year after he was named Big Ten Coach of the Year. And, of course, what Fred Hoiberg and Nebraska did with 23 wins. I know it ended in a disappointing fashion for the Huskers, not being able to get an NCAA tournament win, but it seems like that program has kind of turned the same corner that Northwestern maybe turned a couple of years ago.
It's a great example of what makes this conference so good in basketball. Now we got four new schools coming in, but those two teams, traditionally you would not think of Nebraska or Northwestern as a top of the Big Ten team. Well, both those, they finished third and fourth in our league, and the coaching from top to bottom is so good in this league. It's so hard to win games in conference play. And so what Chris Collins did with that ball club, battling through some injuries, what was maybe a more impressive job than the year before when he was Big Ten Coach of the Year. And then Fred Hoiberg, what he's established in Nebraska, their fan support, the year they had. I mean, it just shows it is tough to win in this league, and now you can't count out anybody.
Not just a talented and deep coaching staff here in the Big Ten, but one that's had a lot of stability over the years. Of course, every year there's change, and that has been the case this season in the Big Ten as well. Ohio State struggled. Chris Holtman was let go. Jake Diebler was the interim head coach and then had the interim tag taken off after a terrific run throughout the postseason at both the Big Ten tournament and in the NIT. And Juwan Howard departs after a disappointing tenure, certainly the last part of it, at Michigan, replaced by Dusty May, who's done such great work at Florida Atlantic, has Big Ten ties, went to IU, was a student manager on Indiana teams under Bob Knight. How quickly do you think he impacts a Michigan program that the last season or season and a half was really not in a great place?
Well, with the transfer portal now, you have the opportunity to have an immediate impact, get older, get experienced guys, get talented guys in right away, not have to realize as much on freshmen and development. He's got a couple great players, two of the best in the country at Florida Atlantic, John L. Davis, Vlad Golden. We'll see if they follow him to Michigan. I think Dusty May's a great hire. I think he's got the youth, the energy. The way that they played at Florida Atlantic, a modern brand of basketball, four out, five out basketball, lets his guards go, I think is a great pickup for Michigan.
If Davis and Golden do decide to go to Ann Arbor, it completely flips what the expectations would be for Michigan next year, because then you have a scorer, you have a legit big, and you can surround them with the pieces that are already there or other recruits or transfers, because everything right now is moving in the world of college basketball. I will call myself out because you and I discussed Jake Diebler's possibility of being the permanent head coach when he was given the interim tag. And I said, I don't think there's any way. Ohio State had a new AD and Ross Bjork coming in as Gene Smith retires. Most ADs want to put their own stamp on a program. I thought he'd want to go out and get a big, splashy hire. And then Diebler did what he did, the win over Purdue, the move in the Big Ten tournament, the run through the NIT. He's an Ohio guy through and through, and they decide to elevate him to the permanent head coach. Your thoughts on that decision and what's expected of him next year in Columbus?
I'm a little biased. I like the Diebler family. I know
you
Diebler
do.
Pretty well. But, look, it's not just that he won in those 6 weeks or so at the helm as the leader for this basketball team. I think it's how he did it. And the ADs at Ohio State, the university got to see how he led, how he communicated, the support that he how he galvanized this the current roster of team, but also alums. I know a number of former Buckeye players, and they were really pulling, rooting for Jake Diebler. Again, another guy, Rick, he's young. I think he's ready for this new era of college basketball. This is a different game now, and I think he's primed to have great success at Ohio State as a head coach.
Also, some changes at schools that will be Big Ten institutions as of August of this coming year. USC saw Andy Enfield leave his job to take the head coach job at SMU, so that opened up the Trojan job. In steps Eric Musselman, who had a very successful run at Arkansas. He's been kind of everywhere. And then another young guy on the up and up, Danny Sprinkle, moves up a level to take the head job at Washington.
This domino effect of these coaching changes
is
really fascinating. Yeah, I mean, Eric Musselman's a guy that's a ton of energy, has recruited well, had success, went to Sweet 16s at Nevada, has been to two Elite Eights at Arkansas. He's just a really good coach. Rick, you mentioned everywhere. G League, International, NBA. He's done at a high, high level at the college game. I expect him to hit the ground running at USC. And then Danny Sprinkle at Washington. He's had success at his alma mater, Montana State, to the NCAA tournament. At Utah State last year, winning a game in the NCAA tournament. So guys that have had success getting to the tournament, winning games in the tournament. Again, we talk about the coaches in this league. I think that's what makes it so good. And now you have four new teams. Two of those teams with new coaches, and I think they're going to do really well. Next year, I think it's just going to be so much fun when you incorporate these four new teams, and is it four new coaches now as well?
We talk about the transfer portal and how much it changes the way that college basketball is played. It changes the rosters. It also changes the coaching job, Trent, because now these guys are not just recruiting in the traditional way. Matt Painter's a perfect example, right? Still wants to go the high school route. Other coaches have to decide if you're a guy like Dusty May or Eric Musselman and you step into a high-profile job and success is expected immediately, isn't the easiest way to do it to find a ready-made guy who's already been an established player at a different institution and convince him to come to your campus?
These are the most important, you know, next 4 to 8 weeks, the most important time of the year for these coaches and their teams. And for sure, Rick, I think typically a 22-year-old who's been through the battles of college basketball, who's had success, who's gone through some adversity, who's had some success, is going to fare better than an 18-year-old. Nowadays, it's so hard as a freshman to come in and contribute to winning basketball at the highest level. We've seen it. And even some guys that maybe weren't at the top of transfer lists, a Lance Jones for Purdue, a Marcus Damask, a Rink Mass, some guys that come from a smaller level and then were able to elevate their games because, hey, they've done it for a number of years. They produce at a high level. So it's hard. These coaches have to make decisions quickly on who to take and how to bring a roster together. But it does give those new guys a great opportunity to have success, a much better opportunity, I believe, in year one.
The Jones and Damask story to me is so intriguing. You're at the same school, and then you transfer. Jones goes to Purdue. They go all the way to the NCAA title game. Damask goes to Illinois. He's all Big Ten first team and takes Illinois to the Elite Eight. Coaches are out there now trying to search for that next program where the guys are being developed that same way so they can come into the Big Ten and have success in a Power 5 league immediately. We'll talk transfers much more and how they could affect next season and debate decisions on college versus cash when we return. Some of the Big Ten's best mulling that question made famous by The Clash. Should I stay or should I go?